Hello. In this second mind map, we are going to look specifically at two big areas of CNS pathology, namely CNS tumors followed by CNS infections. And these are just very broad overviews, just to give you a scheme so that you can classify these conditions better. So let's start off by looking at CNS tumors. And there are three very important clinical aspects that we want to pay attention to. The first is age of the patient. The second is the site or location of the tumor within the brain. And the third is two very important aspects of relevant history. In terms of age, I'm only going to break it down into children versus adults. So the spectrum of types of tumors is a bit different in children versus adults, and I'll elaborate more later. In terms of relevant history, it is of course very important to know if there is a history of malignancy, because the brain is one of the catchment areas of metastatic tumors. So this is an important differential diagnosis. The tumors may be primary or they may be secondary. The other important history point to take is whether the patient is immunocompromised, because immunocompromised patients are at higher risk of developing primary CNS lymphoma and this very important differential diagnosis of infection. These two conditions can look quite similar on imaging. Now, moving on to site. The actual location or the site of origin of the tumor within the brain gives us a good clue to the histogenesis because, you know, literally of the types of cells that are found in that particular location. So this actually helps us to narrow down to the actual histologic type of tumor. And we're going to look at various sites starting from outside in. So here we start off with the meninges, and indeed one of the commonest primary CNS tumors is the meningioma. These are tumors that arise from the meningeal cells. And here is an example of a meningioma. It is located in the midline because it is closely associated with the false cerebri. And this has a very whorled cut surface and looks quite different in texture from the rest of the brain. You can also see that this tumor is very well demarcated from the rest of the brain, as opposed to primary brain parenchymal tumors, which are usually not so well demarcated. Now we're going to focus on the brain parenchyma itself. And of course, we know that neurons lie in the brain parenchyma, and one neuronal tumor is the central neurocytoma. This tumor, very interestingly, tends to occur within or in very close association with the third ventricle. In addition, we also know that glial cells or glial tissue makes up a large part of the brain parenchyma, and tumors that arise from these are known as gliomas. So there are several different types of gliomas according to the different types of glial cells. There are the astrocytomas, and I'm going to give you two examples at the opposite extremes. We have the low-grade astrocytomas, and one example, which is grade 1, is the pilocytic astrocytoma. This is a slow-growing tumor that tends to have a good prognosis if excised completely. On the other hand, on the opposite end of the spectrum is a grade 4 tumor known as the glioblastoma. This is a very aggressive tumor and unfortunately has a very poor prognosis. Other types of gliomas include oligodendrogliomas, which arise from the oligodendrocytes. These are the cells that help to supply nutrients to the neurons. And ependymomas, which arise from ependymal cells. So very interestingly, these tumors can arise in the parenchyma as well as in the periventricular location and the spinal cord. The next big group of parenchymal tumors are the embryonal tumors, and here is just a very important example to take note of, and this is the medulloblastoma. This occurs in the infratentorial location, often in the cerebellum, and here is an example, and we can see the cerebellum, there is a tumor in the midline, and over here is this blackish area of hemorrhage. So this is one of the tumors that occurs in children. It is a primitive or embryonal tumor and occurs in young children. We are going to move on to tumors that are related to the ventricles, so periventricular or intraventricular tumors. And one example, as mentioned earlier, is the ependymoma, which you will recall is also a type of glioma or glial tumor. And of course, naturally, choroid plexus tumors occur in the ventricles. This is also a tumor that arises in children, similar to ependymoma. And we have also mentioned earlier the central neurocytoma that is usually very closely related to the third ventricle. So the last location that we are focusing on are tumors that arise in the midline, and these include germ cell tumors. This again, of course, arises in children and teenagers or young adults. And the other important tumor is the pituitary tumors. And these are special because not only can they give rise to mass effect in terms of compression on the neighboring optic chiasm, this gives rise to visual field defects. And these tumors can also give rise to endocrine abnormalities because, after all, the pituitary gland is an endocrine gland. Let's pull back a little and appreciate a very important concept, that is the genetic profile of CNS tumors is extremely important. And by this, I mean the types of molecular aberrations in tumors. This is especially important in glial tumors or gliomas and also in medulloblastoma. Very often, these tumors are defined by their genetic profile. So they have to have a particular genetic aberration in order to be called a particular type of glioma. And therefore, the molecular profile is important for diagnosis. It is also important for prognosis and for management of these tumors. And the last point I want to highlight is the importance of age. So I'm just going to show you a few tumors that arise in children in particular. So pilocytic astrocytoma is one of them, ependymoma, medulloblastoma, not surprising being an embryonal tumor, choroid plexus tumors, and of course, germ cell tumors as well. So now we're going to move on to look at CNS infections. And there are two aspects that we want to focus on. One is the pattern of CNS involvement. This also correlates with the patient's clinical picture as well as the imaging, of course. And on the other hand, we want to look at the types of organisms that can give rise to CNS infections. So let's start by focusing on the patterns of CNS involvement. And we have meningitis, which is usually inflammation and exudates within the subarachnoid space. Encephalitis, where the brain parenchyma is involved. This is a little bit more diffuse. And we also have a combination, meningoencephalitis. And finally, we have localized parenchymal infections, for example, brain abscess. One of the big groups of organisms, of course, is bacterial organisms, and these tend to give rise to meningitis, purulent meningitis, where there is suppurative inflammation in the subarachnoid space. Bacterial organisms can also give rise to brain abscess in terms of localized parenchymal infections. Viral organisms can give rise to meningitis, and this is termed aseptic meningitis. We don't usually get a lot of neutrophils. Instead, we often get more lymphocytes when we examine the CSF. This can also give rise to encephalitis and meningoencephalitis. Fungal organisms can give rise to meningitis as well, and also localized parenchymal infections. And parasitic organisms can also give rise to localized parenchymal infection. And the last group, which is not really an organism, it is an abnormal protein. This, of course, is the prion protein diseases. These can give rise usually to localized parenchymal infections. So very briefly, what are the types of investigations that we can do when CNS infections are suspected? We can, of course, examine the CSF, cerebrospinal fluid, for example, from a lumbar puncture. This can be sent to the microbiology lab, and stains for bacterial organisms, fungal organisms can be done, PCR tests for specific organisms, and of course, culture and sensitivity can be done. CSFs can also be examined in the biochemistry lab, specifically looking at protein and glucose levels, which differ depending on whether it's a bacterial or viral infection. And of course, the CSF can also be sent to the pathology lab, where we look at the cells, the cytology, to look at the cell type, whether they are lymphocytes or whether they are neutrophils. We can also do imaging to localize the infection, and blood cultures, of course, to isolate the organism. And electroencephalogram, EEGs, can also be done. They have particular aberrations, and this is very well described in prion diseases. So here is a very brief overview of two big groups of pathology in the CNS, CNS tumors, and CNS infections. Thank you.